الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور انفسنا ومن سيئات اعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله صلوات ربه وسلامه عليه وعلى اله واصحابه ومن دعا بدعوته الى الدين اما بعد brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, in the verse often quoted, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu la tamutunna illa wa antum muslimun. Allah says, O you people who believe, do not pass away, do not die, except as Muslims, except instead of Iman, except with taqwa in your hearts. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, to make us with those who will die as Muslim and with taqwa in our hearts, inshallah. Of course, this is not an easy task. Easier said than done. To say that we can to die as Muslims is very easy, but to actually imbibe that idea and to make it part of our lives needs sacrifice, and it needs hard work, and it needs knowledge. You can't get it without knowledge. Without ilm, the ibadah is not accepted. Ibadah without ilm, and ilm without ibadah, of course, is useless. If you just have knowledge and you don't practice it to serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course, then it is not beneficial. The often asked question is, we are now 1437 of the Hijrah, so more than 1400 years has passed since Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was not only sent, he was sent also as the final messenger, the only messenger that was sent as the final messenger. In other words, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had a lot of faith in this ummah, that this ummah would not distort the teaching of the Quran. The sunnah, this ummah would not distort the teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That this ummah can be entrusted with a message until the last day. So we have a great responsibility. The Jews and the Christians changed their faith, they changed their religion, they changed their belief, and they changed it to such a degree that today they are not recognized anymore as being Christian or Jew. In fact, they lost the original books. There is no Bible written in the language of Isa alayhi salam. So even if they should find a Bible in Aramaic today, in the language of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, nobody would be able to understand that. That is how far the Christians have come. Are we far from that? Are we near to that? Are we also like that? Then we have a book in the original language which we also don't understand. I don't know. Well, some of us understand. So we have this great responsibility. And the Sahaba recognized this responsibility. Sahaba recognized the responsibility of teaching and admonishing and giving the good news of Jannah and giving and telling us how to reach Jannah. Because that's your objective of life. What is your objective of life? And as you get older, you realize that is the only thing you need to work for you, is to work for the Jannah. And so Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, and we know Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, was one of the foremost Sahaba of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The name is very well known to all of us. He was one day speaking to a group of the Tabi'een. Who were the Tabi'een? The Tabi'een was the second best generation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created after the generation of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had said, Khairu qurun qarni. The best generation is my generation. So the best generation ever in this last time of Qiyam was the generation of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the second best generation were the Tabi'een. Those who came after the Sahaba, companions of the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were the Tabi'een. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, this was after the time of Abu Bakr, Umar, and Ali, and Uthman, all the great ones had passed on. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was addressing the Tabi'een. What did he say to the Tabi'een? He said to the Tabi'een, من كان مستنا
فَلْيَسْتَنَّ بِمَنْ قَدْ مَاتْ. And I'm sure this talk was given to the Tabi'een at a time when Abdullah ibn Mas'ud saw that slight deviations were creeping into the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, one day, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud came into the masjid and the person added something to the adhan, like we do today. So, Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala nabi, put salawat on the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after or before the adhan. I made salat one day, not so long ago, with a group of people who after the iqamah also put salawat on the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud walked out of the masjid. He walked out of the masjid. And so, some other sahaba said, well, you could, you know, the adhan just went. I mean, you know, you can't leave the masjid after the adhan as well. Why are you leaving the masjid? He said, I'm leaving, the bid'ah is chasing me out of the masjid. This is not the deen that Muhammad taught me. This is not how Muhammad taught me. So this is not the house of Allah, this is some other house, some other God. Because this is not what Muhammad came with. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud saw this and he gave this talk to the Tabi'een. What did he say? He said, مَنْ كَانَ مُسْتَنًا فَلْيَسْتَنَّ بِمَنْ قَدْ مَاتْ. He said, those who are seeking a path. Because today, you know, we have this new age spirituality. You know, the new age spirituality. Everybody's seeking a leader, a sheikh, a peer, some kind of a man with a big beard and a big turban that appears in television. Often, maybe, you know, we want to follow that person. To the exclusion of everybody else. To the exclusion of the Sahaba, to the exclusion of understanding the Quran, to the exclusion of everything. They feel that is their path of salvation. This is new age spirituality. New age spirituality is also about not wanting to know what the Quran says or what, how Muhammad lived or how the Sahaba lived, but to have a veneer of Islam, to have the outward pretenses of being a Muslim, having the beard, the topi, the kurta, and so forth and so on, and the actual practice and following of Muhammad is not there. We're not interested in that. We're not interested in that. Muharram comes, what are we interested in? We want to hear what all the bid'ah must do in Muharram. What must you do? What is Muharram? You know? What must you do on the first of Muharram? Second of Muharram? The third of Muharram? The tenth of Muharram? Well, the tenth of Muharram, we know that it's Sunnah of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Fasted on that day. And so we also say we create our own deen around this. We say, well, Muharram, don't get married in Muharram. You know, the old people say, you must get married in Muharram. It's not a good one to get married. Don't do this in Muharram, or don't start a new job in Muharram, or don't, you know, take Muharram, take a holiday in Muharram, you know, don't do anything really because, you know, something may happen to you. Like Safar, the old people say, Safar is a bad month. They say, don't get married in Safar. Wait until after Safar. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, those who are seeking a path, seek a path of those who have passed away. He said, seek a path that was followed by those who had passed away, who are deceased. What did he mean by this? Didn't mean he was done, you know, go to the kramat and do that. No, no. He said, فَإِنَّ الْحَيِّ لَا تُؤْمَنْ عَلَيْهِ الْفِتْنَةِ. He said, seek a path of those who had passed away. Because the living, those who are alive. Remember we speak to the Tabi'een, speaking to the people who met the Sahaba. So it was an informed audience. It wasn't just any audience. It was an informed audience. Audience who knew the Quran, audience who knew the Hadith of the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he said, because he says, the living could fail in their trials which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to them. So if you're now 40 or 50, we know life is a test. Life is a trial. And when do we know that we've passed the trial? We've been successful. The day that we die. Because now you know, if you die as a good Muslim, and you die with your salat, your zakat, your hajj, and your good manners, and you look after your family and your wife, and your neighbors, mashallah, then they say that is a good man, he passed away. until that day, anything can happen. Because then Nabi Sallallahu said, some people will get up in the morning as a Muslim and die as a kafir. Some people will go to sleep as a kafir in the morning, they wake up, they say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. So we don't know tomorrow, we only know today about ourselves. And we know when the Prophet died, everybody knew him and saw him are called companions, but there were some companions that turned away after he died. They didn't want to pay the zakat to Abu Bakr. And Abu Bakr Siddiq declared them murtad. And Abu Bakr Siddiq took an army and fought them and killed them in the battle, despite the fact that they made salah and they fasted and they said everything else, despite the fact that they said la ilaha illallah. Just because they rejected one follower of Islam and they didn't want to give it to Abu Bakr, said, no, Prophet is dead now. You know, when it comes to money, people with all kinds of excuses, they said, Nabi is dead. No, we don't give it to anybody. There's no one to give it to. So, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud says, فَإِنَّ الْحَيْءِ لَا تُعْمَرْ. Because the living person, you don't know what, how he will be tomorrow, or next week, or next year, you don't know. You don't know how he's going to die. Some people go crazy when they die. The man dies with a big turban in his head, but he swears at people, and he says all kinds of things, funny things, and he's maybe a leader of some movement for many, many years, and that's how he passes away. And the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi said, don't look at how people are when they're young. Look at them when they're old. See how they practice the deen when they're old. That's an indication of what the akhir will be. Then he said, who are these people who are dead? Ulaika ashab Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, these people that have passed away are the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muhammadun Rasulullah wal-lalina ma'amu أشداه على الكفار رحماء بينهم تراهم ركعا سجدا يبتغون فضلا من الله ورضوانا سيمان في وجوههم من أثر السجود. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the Sahaba in the Quran. Muhammad رسول الله says Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala والذين معه and those who are with him meaning his companions. أَشِدَّهُ عَلَى الْكُفَّارِ. When it comes to the enemies of Islam, they are very firm and very strong. رُحَنَاهُ بَيْنَهُ. But when it comes to their relationship among themselves, they're very soft, very compassionate, very loving, very giving, very sharing. تَرَاهُمْ رُكَّعًا سُجَّدًا. Allah says, you will see them making ruku and sujood them. يَبَدَهُونَ فَضْلًا مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرَضُوَانًا. Why do they make ruku and sujood? Seeking the blessing and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. سِيمَاهُمْ فِي وُجُوهِهِمْ مِنْ أَثَرِ السُّجُودِ. You will see the marks of the sujood on their faces. What does it mean? You will see the marks of their worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on their faces. So, we cannot for one moment replace the example of the Sahaba with any other people, person, or personality. Neither can we replace the personality of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, speaking to the Tabi'in, he says, Kana afdal min hadhi umma. They were the best of this umma. They were the best of this umma. Sahaba of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَأَبَرُّ أَقْلُوبًا. They were the most pious in their hearts. In their hearts, they were the most pious. وَأَعْمَقُهَا عِلْمًا. He says they were... Today there are people with more knowledge than the Sahaba. After the Sahaba, a lot of people with more knowledge. I mean, if you look at Imam Bukhari, for example, he had known the whole thousands of hadith of all the Sahaba he knew. But the highest number of hadith narrated by one Sahaba was maybe 1,500. Abu Huraira maybe narrated about 1,500 hadith. But Imam Bukhari collected all the hadith. So in amount of knowledge. People who came after had more knowledge. But Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said they didn't have the depth of knowledge of the Sahaba. What does it mean, the depth of knowledge? Amtu al-ilm. What does it mean? It means they did not have the experience of listening to the revelation as it came to the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They didn't know the circumstances of revelation. They didn't know the circumstances of when the Nabi alayhi wa sallam said the hadith which he said. They were there present. When there was an happening, when they heard the hadith, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that. So they had this deep knowledge of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just as they are. They were the most sincere, most pious. They weren't people who pretended to be Muslim or to the name of Islam. No, they were the sincerest of Muslims. When they heard something, they didn't question it from the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. They practiced it exactly as the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told them. So the Sahaba of the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam have been given not only the stamp of approval of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, also the stamp of approval of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, how does Allah describe the companions? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, radiyallahu anhum wa radu'an. Radiyallahu anhum wa radu'an. Allah is pleased with them and they are pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanallah, imagine, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes man. Allah says, I'm pleased with them, they are pleased with me. Subhanallah. That was the status of the Sahaba alayhi as-salatu wassalam. That is why the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to make the following dua, where he says, Ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala dinik. You've heard the dua of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What does this dua mean? Ya muqallib al-qulub. The word qalb, as you know, means heart in Arabic. But the word qallaba yuqallibu, the verb where it comes from, it means that which can turn like that. Qallaba means to turn like that. Or to move up and down. I mean something which can turn from one day the heart turns like that, you know, the next day it turns like that. The one day somebody is your friend, the next day is your enemy. The one day you like the food, the next day you don't like the food. The one day you like the dress, the next day you don't like the dress. The day you buy a new suit, in 3 weeks' time you don't like it anymore. Some people buy a car today in the morning and they say, I shouldn't have bought this car. Mashallah, it's a brand new car, nothing wrong with it. But that's the heart of man. Today he loves somebody, tomorrow he doesn't like it, that person anymore. So the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam asked Allah, Ya Muqallib al-Qulub. He said, oh Allah, the one who turns the hearts of man. ثَبِّتْ قَلْبِي عَلَى دِينِ. What did the Nabi say? Wow, what was the circumstance under which Muhammad didn't want his heart to move? He wanted his heart to be stable. He said, I want to stabilize my heart on your deed. Let my heart falter in the position. You know, when Aisha used to, Aisha was very jealous, so Aisha sometimes used to tell me, what did the other wife make today? You didn't eat by me today. You spend 5 minutes longer than today, what is it? And she was jealous of some of the wives because some of them were prettier than she was. Quite a few was quite prettier than what Aisha was. And Aisha and Asma, they were a couple. Aisha and Asma, these two wives. Aisha stayed there and Asma stayed here. If this is a Majid al-Nabawi, and this was the mihrab, and Aisha stayed there, as we know. The back stayed Asma. And the two of them always discussed the other wives. Who's prettier, who they think Nabi likes more, and so forth and so on. So, Nabi Sallallahu was asked, why, you know, your first wife Khadija, she'd already passed away, but you know, you seem to have more love for her than for any of your other wives, and she's gone. And he says, you see, when it comes to matters of the heart, I have no control. That is why, when it comes to having more than one wife, we are required to give them equal in material things. So if you give the one a three bedroom one, you give the other one a three bedroom. You spend that 1 hour with the one, you spend 1 hour with that. You give this, the rest of the one, you must give. But love, you can't love two people equally. It's impossible. So even the Prophet said he couldn't do it. And so the Nabi asked for this stability of our heart in the deen of Allah, that we mustn't waver in our faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That we mustn't be distracted by new age philosophies or by secular Sufism that we have today. You know, the man, 5 days a week, 6 days, 5 days a week, he's a CEO in a company, he's a suit and a tie, Saturdays and Sundays he's a Sufi. And then Monday he goes back to work and he becomes a secular person again, and then weekends he becomes something else. And then, it's how it is. This is the new kind of faith. So Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam asked, let me not be like that. Let me be, try and be the same every day. Make myself every day. Be the same person every day. So Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says that, Abdullah bin Mas'ud says, that the companions came with the best generation. Why did the best generation? Because the only people that we know are definitely going to Jannah are the Sahaba. Nobody knows. Anybody else would know? Only people we know that will go to Jannah are the Sahaba alayhi wasallam. And all the Sahaba alayhi wasallam, there are 10 that have been promised Jannah on the dunya. 10 of them. Subhanallah. So, if I want to open a business selling cars, do I follow somebody? Do I take my lesson from a person whose car business collapsed? Of course not. You don't go to a person and say, brother, you've been very successful. Can you give me some tips? Can you guide me? So, if we are going to go to Jannah, who should we try and find out what they did when they were? People will promise Jannah. People guarantee Jannah, isn't it? People will guarantee Jannah. They are the people that we should know. That we should study their, lives and say, what did this man do that he was promised Jannah to do it before he even died, before he even comes in front of Allah? These are the people we should know. Ashra, Mubashra, they're called the 10 people who have been promised Jannah on the dunya. Those who are Badr, for example, they'll all go to Jannah. 313, every single one of them will go to Jannah. No matter what they did afterwards, they guarantee Jannah. Why? Because each one of them were chosen to be a Badr. Why do I say that? Because a lot of the great Sahaba of the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam were not at Badr, even though they were in Medina. And we'll hear some of them were not. And why didn't they come to the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? Because the message that was given was that the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was going to do what? He was going to intercept a caravan coming from Syria to Makkah. Because remember, the Jahiliyyah, the Quraysh had, what is the word? Expelled the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and the Muslims, and took all their possessions. Some, and even leave their wives behind and their children. Subhanallah. So this was a way of getting back some of the stuff which they took from the Sahaba and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that was the deal. It was, we're going to Badr. And no, we're going not to Badr, we're going to intercept this caravan. As it comes along the sea route to Makkah, we're going to, and we're going to wait for them, but the Prophet gave his news on Medina, wants to go with them. So some people thought, you know, just a ghazwa, intercepting of a caravan and taking booty. No need to go. And of course, when they got there, their whole situation changed. And became the greatest battle ever fought in the history of man. Because if it wasn't for the victory in that battle, subhanAllah, Allah knows better. Allah alam. But Islam would have died there at Badr. So a lot of Sahaba are very pained and very sad at the fact that they weren't in Badr. So those 350, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose every single one of them to be there. They were the sincerest, purest of the crop of Sahaba that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given as companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, really, I mean, if I'm an intelligent person, whether I'm in business or whether I'm in deen, I'll try and follow the best example. The most successful. The shortest route to Jannah, isn't it? That's the shortest route to Jannah. So follow those who were promised Jannah during their life. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud then gives some examples of why we should follow them. He said, "Kana afdal hadhihi al-ummah wa abar wa quruba." They were the best of this ummah. And they were the most sincerest of this ummah. And they had a deep debt. They may not have had as much knowledge as we have today. We have the internet, we know so many things. But they had the depth of knowledge, they had the experience. And we always say, you know, there's no substitute for two things. Experience and intelligence. You either have it or you don't have it. You can cultivate knowledge, but wisdom and the depth is something which comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Similarly with fiqh. Sahaba knew the law, but it rested on the shoulders of the likes of Shafi'i, Abu Hanifa, Ahmad ibn Hanbal. To not only take the legal cases or decisions taken by Sayyid Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, but they took the legal decisions of all the Sahaba and they made it into a madhhab. So they knew what all the Sahaba, the decisions they had given. So they had more knowledge in the Sahaba of the law. But the Sahaba had the depth and the closeness to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So those who come after the Sahaba in terms of knowledge, we're only scratching the surface. We're only scratching the surface. We're only reading and trying to understand. It is those who were there that knew the depth and the true understanding of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud describes the Sahaba as they were the least superficial people. You know, superficiality has become the thing today. It's all about how you look. You look at the TV and magazines and newspaper. It's all about the look. But Sahaba were not like that. They didn't put up a front. They were not superficial. They did not pretend as to what they were and who they were. They were very simple people. Simplicity was their way. And where did they get this lesson from? Of course, we know the first lesson was from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was a very simple man, slept on the floor, cleaned his own house, etc., etc., etc. When they went to Badr, there were three of them, Ali, the Prophet, and another Sahabi, who had one horse. And the two young Sahabis, they were Ali was 21 and the other one was 23. They were very young. The Prophet was already in his 50s. So they decided that they were going to walk to Badr and they would let the Prophet ride. Obviously they were going to do that. I mean, I would do that, you would do that, even if I'm 7 years old. I'm not going to let the Prophet walk and I settle that. So they said, "Ya Rasulullah, we've worked out that we will walk and you will ride." If the Prophet was a Sheikh or a Mawlana or a Mufti or an Imam or a member of some big religious council, he would say, "I'm going to, you know, ride in the car and you guys can take the bus or the taxi and we can walk." And that is just how it is. That's how it should be. You must have respect, you know. What did the Prophet say? He smiled and he said, "You want to deprive me of the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by riding on this camel the whole way?" "I also want to be rewarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I want to walk my distance. And you will ride, and a third I will ride, and a third you will ride, subhanAllah." And when Abu Bakr at the time of Hijrah, this was the Prophet, the time of Hijrah when he was in there, when the Prophet said, "I'm leaving now," because the news went out that they were going to kill the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said to Abu Bakr, "I'm leaving right now, now. We're not packing, we're not sending the car for the service, and we're not switching the alarm, we're not taking the alert. We just now. So Abu Bakr said, "Yeah, I'm ready." Abu Bakr said, "What do you mean?" He said, "I've always been ready. Whenever you have ready, let's go." So he came with two camels. So he said, now I've got the camels also. This is your camel, this is my camel. That's a true friend, isn't it? SubhanAllah. So the Prophet said, No. How much do you want for this camel? He said, this is not time to trade now. This is not really, you know, they're going to kill you, don't you? You know, this is a gift from me. No. He said, why not? Prophet said, but you know, I'm like you, I'm a human being like you, I'm a prophet, but I want more reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If I take this camel from you, I'm not going to get the reward if you give it to me as a gift, but if I pay you for it, my camel. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward me for every step that this camel takes, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that was this the mindset that was transferred from the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the Sahaba alayhi wa sallam. They understood the Quran. They understood what they had to understand. So, I was thinking the other day, there are two questions that we ask when people get married, for example. So I'm asked a lot to say, I don't speak at weddings anymore unless it's a the Queen of England that comes. But, you know, people always say, talk about marriage. The two questions are always, what is the role of the husband and what is the role of the wife? I mean, that's the old question. What are the rights of the wife? What's the right of the husband? You know, how is the relationship? What brings a successful marriage? And we say a lot of things. I've been speaking about Islam, you say this, then you say this, then you say that, then you say there must be understanding, and then you say there must be this, and they must make salah together, and they must do this, and you know, and you must smile with your wife, and Allah, after if you smile with your wife, Allah smiles with you, and you know, we have all these. But really, the answer lies only in one book in the Quran. The answer to that lies only in the Quran. So, I think, but really, the Quran is the answer to that kind of relationship, which is a relationship that will work. And it's a verse that I mean, the verse is there, often quoted, maybe you don't understand, maybe I didn't understand it properly. But the verse says, what does the verse say? The verse says, what is the famous verse that we quote? Litaskunu ilayha. Famous word in the verse. Litaskunu ilayha. So what is the role of the wife? What is the role of a wife in the Quran? And we know all the, you know, we know she can't, she doesn't have to cook, and she doesn't have to do this, and she doesn't have to do this, and you must pay her to feed your children, and so forth and so on, you know that. But what is the essential role of a wife? The essential role. And the Quran gives us the essential role of a wife in Islam. The Quran says, لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيَا. What is this, لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيَا? What does this mean, litaskunu ilayha? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the role of the wife is for the husband to find tranquility in his wife. So what is the role of the wife? The role of the wife is to provide peace and tranquility to the husband. That's the only role that the Quran speaks. Nothing else. That is the 120% contribution to the wife to the marriage. And if you have that, you'll have a successful marriage, because that's what the Quran says. And then the Quran talk, that is the wife herself, only she must do that. What must she provide? She must be a haven of peace and tranquility for the husband. So when he comes from work, for example, he opens the gate, he must smell. Ah, that's my favorite dish, my wife. I can smell the samosas, mashallah. That's not chicken samosas, that's milsam. Oh, she's made the mado food today. Ah, that's my favorite food. And he comes and opens the door, and there she stands. Not in a black abaya. Women, you know. Panda is for outside, not for inside. Your wife doesn't come to the door with hijab and burda. No. I'm not saying she must come with a miniskirt. Maybe if you like that, it's allowed. But she must look, she must, when you look at it, she must provide that equality and that peace. You look and say, mashallah, I wonder what my wife is wearing today. At work already, the whole day you're thinking, I wonder which dress she's going to put on today, or you know, which, she's going to put on red lipstick, white lipstick, or whatever. You know, she have her hair done, or whatever, you know. That is the peace that's recorded. And that is a successful marriage. And that's what Sahaba knew. And that's what our parents knew, and their parents before them, that the woman is the homemaker. I'm not saying that, Allah says that. And then Allah says, after that, there her job begins and ends. She's got no other work. She's said to make herself beautiful for you, to make herself worse as whatever you ask her to do for you. Nothing else. That's all she has to do. And then Allah says, وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً. And then I place between you, I, Allah, not from you, it's not from you. That's what I'm doing with you. Allah says, I, my job. So what's your wife's job? Your wife's job is to provide that. You must help her to provide that, actually. And then Allah says, then from me, Allah gives you two gifts. Your marriage gifts. You know, today you must go to home, some shop, you know, they give you a list. You must go there. Then today you can't just buy something to praise. No, it's not your choice anymore. No, it's a wife's, the bride chooses her place, and you must just pay. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I'm also going to give you two gifts. Love comes from Allah if we follow the rules. And mawadda. And what is mawadda? Mawadda is not just love. Hub is love. No, hub is love. The word hub in Arabic means love. What is mawadda? Mawadda is passionate love. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instills in both parties passionate love. Because passionate love is only confined to marriage. You can't have passionate love outside marriage. So Allah says, I will give the passion in the love. So my gift to you is passionate love, wa rahmah and mercy. And that happens between the two. That is a marriage. That's how it should be. Your wife, and this is what a mother must tell her daughter before when she gets married. You must tell your daughter, your job that Allah has given to you, your role is to provide for your husband peace and tranquility. Not if he comes home, how could you do for you in peace? No. She must provide peace and tranquility. So, and as a father also, you tell your daughters, if you could stay at home, provide that atmosphere for your husband, that is a successful marriage. So our parents, for example, were poor. But my mother never worked one day in her life. Although maybe if she had found something to do, we would have had a better quality. But that was how it is. And so the marriage lasted for 50 years and 60 years. Because every day she was at home, making this panna cook and making that, you know, mixing the drinks and middle of summer and put in the fridge, you know, there was no buying, there were 2 liters of coke at the shop, there was no money for that kind of thing. And that is what, so a woman is a homemaker, and this is what the Sahaba was. So when they lived their lives, the Sahaba, they lived their lives according to the Quran. The Quran simplifies the life for us. And so we should carry this over talk, what do I tell our children? What do we tell our, till today we tell our books, we can say, what economics do that? I can't, you have to go to university, you know. Father catches his head more for his daughter today than the sons. Isn't it so? Today we're more worried that our daughters must have degrees. Why do we say that? Oh, is your money in the play? Are you independent? So we are really giving the child, the young daughter, that kind of message. The chances are that, you know, why? And what you're doing is you're setting up for failure. I'm not saying it happens all the time, but I say if we concentrate only on that, we're planting into our mind that divorce can happen, number one. Number two is, don't worry, my girl, if it happens, you're on your own. You can look after yourself. And we need, as fathers, to reverse the situation. We need to go back to the Quran and say, this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from you. Yes, you can have your degree, no problem. Yes, you can go to university, but this is your role as a mother and as a wife. More as a wife than a mother. We have to reprogram the minds of our children. Or in accordance with the Quran, and in accordance with the life of Muhammad, and in accordance with what the Sahaba had done. Only then will we get back to success in this world and the after. So the Sahaba were not pretentious, and they were very simple people. When they spoke clearly, they spoke simply. And that's why did Allah choose the Arabs of Arabia for this mission? That's the other question now. Why did Allah choose the Arabs of Arabia who were illiterate? Live in the middle of the desert. You know when you go to Makkah, what it looks like? I mean, not anymore. But if you just drive outside Makkah, you'll see it's just desert. It's hot, it's dusty, it's desert. There's nothing there. And the Arabs didn't, you know, they only traded. They had nothing. Yet Allah subhanahu gave them the mission of what? Of the 20th century, 21st century, and time of it. They were going to come in the age of technology, and they had to rule the world. They had to lay the foundation to rule the world. Why? Because the Arabs and Arabia were the only nation on earth at that time that was unadulterated, wasn't spoiled. They weren't a spoiled nation, number one. They were not like the other nations of the world. For example, they didn't have luxurious lifestyles. They were very simple. The camel was everything they had. And wherever they moved, they put up a little tent, and there they lived. They moved on and moved on. And they were simple, rural people. They were not like the Persians and the Romans at that time. High life. Well, of course, today the Arabs are different. Today they lived like the Persians and the Romans. But at that time, no. They were illiterate, mostly illiterate people. In Makkah, there were only 16 people who could read and write at the time of Muhammad. So very simple people, couldn't read, couldn't write, lived in the middle of the desert, straightforward, honest, decent people. They were decent people. They were simple in their dress, in their food. They had a little stone god that they worshipped. That was it. They had no great philosophy. They just did this. And that is why Allah chose them, because their nature, their fitrah was pure. Their nature was pure. Like, you know, I hear many people say today, you know, I've had a case some years ago of two doctors who got married. And they're both from Indian origin, the boy and the girl. And the marriage lasted about 3 years. So I saw them and I spoke to them. I said, you know, I know them, you're both, and they come from good families. And they're nice people. I mean, the doctor lady was a very nice person, and the maid man was a very nice person. And I asked him, what is wrong? He said, Sheikh, I'm going to India and get me a girl from the village. I said, why? He said, because that is how I think a wife should be. Unassuming, undemanding, and to be my companion. And he was a professional person. He was now, by that time, he was a specialist. But that's what he wanted. And that's how the Sahaba were. So they were simple in their dress, in their food. Their fitras were clear, meaning their nature. And so when they accepted Islam, they were like a clean page. It was like Islam came down on a clean page. The Sahaba accepted Islam. Islam came to them, and they appreciated the Islam which Allah gave to them. Not like other nations, where when the Quran came, the Quran first has to cleanse their hearts. And I got an email the other day from somebody, I don't know who the lady is. In fact, last week I got this email. And the email says, and I'm still disturbed by this email, but anyone will respond to this email sometime. The email says, Assalamu alaikum Sheikh, I'm reading the Quran. there. He said, I'm reading the Quran. I know it's late to Kushir, actually. And I come across verses in the Quran where Allah uses very bad language. He says, when Allah speaks about the infidels, which is Mushrikun. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, for the quotes, she mentions one verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, talks about killing the Mushrikun. And she says, you know, I always thought that my God is a very merciful God, and a very forgiving God, you know. Why does Allah use this very stern language in the Quran, you know? And now I've stopped reading the Quran. So, that is what happened to when the Quran was given to other nations. Their hearts first had to be cleaned and purified, but not the Arabs. They were like clean plates, clean slates, white sheets of paper. And when the Quran was given to them, they left behind their other lifestyle. Like Omar ibn Khattab is a typical example. He was a man who liked to drink. The moment he became Muslim, finished. That was it. That was the end of his old life. He started a new life. And that is why when you look at bid'ah, for example, something I speak about always, innovation in Islam. Where did the innovation? Not a single innovation started in Makkah or in Medina. Not a single one of the innovations that we practice today. Not one was started either in Makkah or in Medina. And you can ask me anyone that we practice. Where did they come from? They started in Damascus, in Egypt, in what is today known as Iran, in Iraq. This is where it started. Why? Because those people there lived at a time when Greek philosophy was known there, and Persian philosophy was known there, and so many ideologies were there. And they tried to incorporate this into the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like our forefathers. Indonesia was a Hindu kingdom. India is still a Hindu kingdom today. And a lot of those innovations were brought into Islam. And therefore, all the bid'ahs you practice were not started, not in Makkah or in Medina, because of the purity of the fitrah of the Sahaba, alayhi as-salatu wa-salam. And the other thing is, when revelation came to them, they became Muslims, they started practicing immediately. There were no theological discourses about how do we understand this, you know, does Allah sit on the throne, and how do we say Allah sits on the throne, and is Allah everywhere, or is Allah in one place? You know? If Allah is everywhere, then we go on to say Allah is also in the toilet there because Allah is everywhere, and we get these kinds of ideas coming to us. Because we ask all these kinds of theological questions. Then they mentioned, whoa, you were Ash'ari, you know, because you believe like this, and you are a Salafi, you know, because... So I'm not interested in that. I'm not interested in that. Because to me, it's a senseless question to ask, in any case. So, there were no theological discourses. Theological discourses started in the time of the Sahaba. The time of Abu Bakr and Umar. Umar, of course, just took out the sword and chopped off anybody's neck, wanted to start anything new. There was no new age spirituality in the time of the Sahaba alayhi wasallam. You made salah, you gave your zakat, you fasted the month of Ramadan, you were a good Muslim, looked after your wife and your neighbors, and that was it. Why was that it? Because that is what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam came. Then Abdullah Masud said, قوم أختارهم الله لصحبة النبي وإقامة الدين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose the Sahaba, chose them to be the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah chose those illiterate Arabs to be the companions of His most beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is the reason they were chosen. Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍّ حَوَارِيٍّ." Every prophet had helpers, companions. And why were they chosen? Because they had they went through and they fitted the image that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted the world to have of a good Muslim, of a true Muslim. And Allah chose them so well. There was such a perfect choice that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, there will come no other prophet after Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because his companions would look after this deen until the day of Qiyamah. So perfect then. Allah chose them. So it is for us to recognize the virtues of the Sahaba. فَعَلِفُ لَهُمْ فَضْلًا Abdullah ibn Mas'ud goes on in his speech to the Tabi'in. He says, O Muslims, know the virtues of the Sahaba and the status of the Sahaba, the esteem of the Sahaba. Raise their level amongst yourselves. Respect them. And as I said, they are the only people that we know for sure will go to Jannah. And therefore we need to follow and find out why are they going to Jannah. And I said, we will look particularly at the Ashra Mubashra, the 10 persons whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the glad tidings on the dunya that they will go to Jannah. And then Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said to the Tabi'in, وَاتَّبَعُوا فِي آثَارِهِمْ Follow in their footsteps. وَتَمَسَّكُوا مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ أَخْلَاقِهِمْ وَدِينِهِمْ And follow them and hold fast to the Sahaba alayhi salam as much as you can in their character and in their deen. إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا عَلَى الْهُدَى الْمُسْتَقِيمِ Because they were on the right path. They were on the straight path. There was no other path for them. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُمْ Allah is pleased with them and they are pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, عَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءَ الرَّاشِدِينَ مِنْ بَعْدِي عُضُّوا عَلَيْهَا بِالنَّوَاجِدِ Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, follow my sunnah and follow the sunnah of those khulafa. And of course Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam particularly refers to the four sahaba, namely Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman and Ali. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, follow them and whatever they tell you to do and whatever they need, bite on it with your back teeth. In other words, hold on to it. Because why did Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam hold on to it with your back teeth? Because the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knew that a time will come when you will have to bite on your back teeth and grind your back teeth. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the Sahaba, a time will come, and he was telling this to Umar and Abu Bakr and Uthman and Ali, he said, a time will come when one Muslim will be equal to 50 of you. In other words, one Muslim will be equal to 50 Umars. One Muslim will be equal to 50 Abu Bakr. SubhanAllah. Could the Nabi Sassam say that Abu Bakr's iman, you put it on one side of the scale, and you put the iman of the whole of the Ummah on the other side of the scale, the iman of Abu Bakr will be more. Yet, Nabi Sassam said, a time will come. In other words, this time, or after all time, when one Muslim's iman will be bigger than the iman of 50 Abu Bakr. So they ask, why, Ya Rasulullah? I mean, we're here with you, we see you, we love you, we fight for you, we give our life for you. Somebody you don't even know that will come maybe in 2015 or 2016 or the year 3000, he will have be equal to 50 or more. He said, yes. Ask why? He said, because at that time, to be a Muslim will be like holding a hot coal in your hand. And only those with iman will hold the coal. So they said, well, what about us? He said, you love one another. You support one another. And I live amongst you. And you have the pure deen. By the time will come when holding the real deen in your hand will be very dangerous and very difficult. And so when that time comes, the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, those people will be equal to 50 and 60 of you. So, inshallah, I thought that, and maybe I'm being selfish in a sense, to maybe talk a little bit about, or start talking about, the 10 persons who was from the chapter. And today I was in the Sahara, the first one, and obviously I've only managed to do the introduction. And that's me, unfortunately. I'm not a Sahabi. Sahabi spoke for 5 minutes and then everybody understood what they said. And so the Prophet, I'm not a Prophet, I'm not a Sahabi, so I tend to speak a bit longer than the Sahaba alayhi wa salat wa salam. So inshallah, next week we will start with the first Sahabi that was promised Jannah by the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And his name is Malik ibn Sinan radiallahu ta'ala. Some of you may know him, you may have not heard him before, but he was one of those whom the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Battle of Uhud declared to be a man of Jannah. So it's very important for us as Muslims to know why. Because maybe if I knew what that man had done, I would also go to Jannah. And Abu Sufyan, of course, was one of the 10 persons who was promised Jannah. Abu Sufyan, who fought not only the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, but the Muslims for 20 years, he fought Islam. SubhanAllah. He was the embedded enemy, not only of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, but also of Islam. And yet, when he became a Muslim, in the few years that he was a Muslim, man is never too bad to become good and to go to Jannah. And the man is never too good to become bad to go to the other place. So what did Abu Sufyan do in those 1 or 2 years that he was Muslim? That he earned that. He earned first the wrath of Allah. If he had done it, he had said he would have gone to Jannah. But when he became Muslim, in just a few years he would go to Jannah. And what about the others also? So next week, inshallah, Allah grants it. Grants us. To be here, we will look at Malik ibn Sinan, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Inshallah, maybe after that, we will see about the Sahaba. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wal asr, inna insan, inna fi husr, illa lalil aman, ma'adu salihat, inna wazal, 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 inna